Ocala's information station, 1370 WOCA. Ocala.
All right, 25 minutes before 11 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in this Wednesday morning. It is time for Legally Yours. This is the show hosted by John Fuller. John Fuller is an attorney here in Ocala at the law firm of Fuller and Fuller. Janet Fuller is the other Fuller, and John is here to answer your questions about your legal circumstances. The number to call is 622-9622. That is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, and I'll let you know the date so that you know if this is live or not. Today is April 2nd, 2014. If you're listening on the same date as your calendar shows, April 2nd, 2014, then you're listening to a live show. You are invited to call and be part of the show. Good morning, John.
Good morning, Larry. Good morning to our friends who may be listening. I noted when you said the date that we missed April Fool's Day by one day, so maybe that's a good thing.
You might have had some fun with me.
We may have had, you know, but anyhow, I hope you're doing well, and I hope all our listeners are. And we are here to answer questions about the law, the specific legal issues in general ways, and to discuss how it impacts our lives and our interactions with other people and companies and corporations. Janet and I practice general trial law, civil trial law primarily, and business commercial litigation, personal injury, wrongful death cases for seriously injured people. And Janet specializes in Social Security disability law. And so if those are areas that any of our listeners have a specific question, if they or a loved one or a friend have unfortunately been involved in an accident, or if they have a business and have some dispute concerning contract or partnership, shareholders agreements, those are the things that we handle in our office, and we'd be happy to talk with you in the office with an office conference. But if you have any general questions about the legal system or a particular matter of interest with you, then we're glad to talk about it here. We talk about a little bit of everything on this show, we've been very blessed to have good topics that have come up from time to time.
When you are in an automobile accident and you are suing the insurance company of the other driver, are you indeed suing the insurance company, or are you suing the driver?
Interesting question. Very good question. You cannot join the other driver's insurance company anymore. When I started practicing law, you used to be able to sue the negligent driver and join his insurance company under a theory that the negligent driver was a third party, that your client was a third party beneficiary of the policy, which provided coverage for the negligence of its insured. And the Supreme Court ruled on that, and Mr. Justice Irvin, who was a wonderful Florida Supreme Court justice for many years, authored the case. Unfortunately, from the perspective of people who were hurt, the insurance industry lobbied the legislature, and they said, hey, wait a minute, we don't want juries to know that there's an insurance policy back there, and that the individual who's being sued may very likely not be paying the judgment out of his or her pocket. We think that increases the amount of awards if it's going to be coming from some big company as opposed from the John Doe defendant. Right. So they use their substantial lobbying clout, and the legislature passed the law that you cannot join the insurance. So it is not something that is mentioned in the trial. You sue the individual who was driving the vehicle or owned the vehicle, and if you get a judgment, then the insurance company, number one, they have a duty to provide them with a lawyer and a defense and pay all the defense costs for their insured. And if there is an adverse verdict, then they have to pay that verdict to the plaintiff up to the full amount of their policy limits. Now, an interesting aside grows out of that, in that if the insurance company fails to engage in good faith negotiations to try to settle that claim that is brought against their insured by an individual who's been injured by that person's negligence. And let's say they have a $100,000 insurance policy of liability, bodily injury protection, liability, and the plaintiff compiles all the medical records, all the lost wage verification, lost income, sends in a settlement package and offers to settle and give a full release for the payment of $100,000, which are the policy limits. And the big insurance company says, no, we'll give you 90, or we'll give you 50, or we'll give you 10 cents and see you in court. And and then you, after giving them all the information to evaluate the case, giving them a reasonable amount of time to effectively evaluate that claim, and offering to settle within the policy limits, and they refuse or fail to do so under those circumstances, and you go to trial and you get a verdict that is in excess of the policy limits, then you can file a lawsuit directly against the insurance company for bad faith, and they could be held responsible for the excess verdict.
Oh, man. So they must have to put up with that all the time. That must be a daily thing for all the insurance companies. There must be something happening like that all the time.
Yes, and they have a fiduciary duty to their insured and a good faith duty in connection with the whole system to reasonably and fairly negotiate a claim. And if they can settle it within their insured's policy limits, they have a fiduciary duty to their insured to do so. And if they fail to do so because they are putting greater emphasis on the bottom line to their shareholders by trying to hold back monies and not pay the full value of the claim, and it results in an excess verdict over the policy limits, then the person who was hurt has a lawsuit against the insurance company.
I was told one time that if you're in an accident and you get a call from the other insurance company, and the caller says, "Hello, Mr. Larry, how are you?" And I say, I'm fine. How are you? What can I do for you?" That, just by saying you're fine, could be held against you.
Well, you should not under any circumstances make a statement or talk to the adverse insurance company's representative. They are hired for one purpose, and that is to develop the facts that in a manner that is most favorable to their insured and ultimately to their own pecuniary interests. So the watchword is you have a duty to cooperate with your insurance company. But if you, the first thing a person should do, if they, especially if they're seriously injured, they really need to seek counsel. And like I said at the top of the show, if a person who is in a serious automobile accident wants to talk with someone in our firm who handles this, we handle those kind of cases. But otherwise, don't talk to the adverse insurance adjuster
at all. So just saying, "Oh, I'm fine." I mean, it's a kind of
it's a catch 22 because it's more of a greeting. And I know we have a call to go to.
All right. Good morning. You're on the air with John Fuller.
Yes. Good morning, Mr. Fuller.
Good morning.
And thank you for always taking my phone calls. I really enjoy this program, and it's
appreciate
very informative, and it's a wonderful thing.
Always appreciate hearing from you. Thank you for calling.
Today, I'm interested in finding out if I'm going to have some tree work done on my property or roof repair or something like that, and I go out and seek somebody to do the work, and they come, and there's damage done or injury done and so on and so forth. But in the meantime, they presented their business card that said they were bonded and insured, and it turns out that they haven't kept up with that, and they are not bonded and insured. If I get into a lawsuit situation, is it my tough luck that I didn't look a little further to see if they really were bonded and insured?
Well, to go to the last part of the question, from the standpoint of what kind of protection you have that might be available to you, yes, that is probably a difficult position, because if it isn't there, the fact that they said it was there and you relied on it but didn't ask for a copy of their bond or insurance policy to show that it was active and in full force and effect, you can sue them for the damages that they caused that you would be held accountable for, perhaps, as the property owner. And you can sue them. You can also sue them for fraud in the inducement, misrepresentation. There are a number of theories and causes of action that come to mind that you have a wonderful technical legal remedy. If this was something that was given to a law student as a law exam, you could write a very, very fine answer to the exam question and probably do very well with those answers that we just said. Practically speaking, it's like my father used to say, it's very difficult to get blood out of a stone. And if this company has no assets, or if it has assets that are subject to liens, let's say it has no assets, it owns a truck and a couple of chainsaws, and it has a lien on it at the bank where the bank is owed more money than the value of the truck and the chainsaws, and they come in and they've let their insurance lapse and they tell you otherwise, you have a lawsuit against them. You could get a judgment against them, but then converting that into real dollars in your pocket could be very problematical.
Finalization here, what you're saying is that if you do hire somebody and they have a card, you also want to see the paperwork to make sure that is up to date as far as them being bonded and insured.
Right. A certificate that their policy is current in full force and effect. Would be a reasonable thing to ask for, especially if they're going to do any substantial amount of work, or it's in close proximity to your dwelling or the dwelling next door or something like that. I think that's reasonable.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you for calling. Have a great day.
All right. If we get stopped for a speeding ticket and we don't have proof of insurance, or we don't have insurance, let's say, is that a violation that could put us in jail?
I don't believe you could go to jail for it. They could revoke your license. I haven't looked at that in a long time. You have to carry personal injury protection insurance as a condition, but I don't think that that's a criminal offense. In fact, I'm sure it's not.
So, and I'm not trying to be political, but with the health insurance that we just had the deadline 2 days ago, if you're caught without that, I mean, what kind of penalty would there be?
I don't know. That's a very good question. I don't think anybody knows what effect, the health insurance program has. So we have a call.
Yes, sir.
We'll go there.
Good morning. You're on the air.
Good morning, Mr. Fuller. It's always good to talk with you.
Well, thank you. It's always great to hear from you, sir. I hope you're doing well.
I'm doing a lot better.
I'm glad.
Back on the insurance, if someone damages your property, say if a person's drunk or someone running and tear up your fence, and the company calls you and say, yeah, we know our client did this and they were charged, blah, 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 but we're not going to pay you until you get pictures to us, what recourse do you have? Especially if you're Brian and can't take the pictures. I'll hang up and listen to you. It's always good to hear from you.
Thank you. Well, the law requires and presumes that you will take reasonable steps to help yourself. Just because you are the victim of an accident or an incident and where someone's negligence caused you damage, it does not relieve you from the burden of any personal responsibility. They have a right to gather information about the nature and extent of the damages that you have claimed. So if part of those damages are, your car's been wrecked and you're going to be making a claim against them, they have a right to inspect the car for you to send pictures. If you claim that you have been injured and are seeking medical treatment, they're going to want to see copies of the medical bills and the medical reports, the copies of the x-rays or the MRIs or the CT scans. And they have an entitlement before they offer money to have sufficient information provided to them to justify the amount of the claim. You know, if you sprained your ankle as opposed to breaking your neck, you couldn't call up and say, your insured's at fault. I'm not going to tell you what my damages are or what my injuries are, and I'm not going to give you any information to verify it, but I'd like you to send me a check for $1 million. You're not going to get anywhere with that.
Yeah,
so,
right.
So that, you know, but again, those are the kinds of things that if you're in an accident where you have serious injury, you really need to consult with a lawyer and let them start. And it's important to do that in a very timely manner. Number one, we've talked many times about you have to get your doctor's care within 14 days
right,
for your personal
right.
injury protection. But in addition to that, it's very important to have someone on your side investigating the accident and the mechanics of how it occurred and finding witnesses, interviewing witnesses, photographing the vehicles, photographing the roadway where the accident occurred, because skid marks dissipate with weather. The cars are not going to stay in their wrecked condition forever. They're either going to be fixed or sold for salvage
right,
if they're
right.
not fixable. And if you have a scar or a laceration, it's not going to look the same 3 months after the accident as it does at the time you're injured. So all of those things ought to be photographed and documented. And people who are witnesses, they're sometimes hard to locate. They don't always show up on the accident report. But what we like to do in a case of significant damages is have our investigator go door to door in the area where the accident occurred and ask people, were you home? Did you see? Did
right.
you hear?
Mm-hmm.
Did you go to the scene? There's no shortcut to preparation and hard work. And those are the things that need to be done. And even if you locate witnesses, but you wait to go to a lawyer who starts looking for those witnesses until 6 months or 8 months after the accident, those people who saw things that are important may have moved away.
Yes.
Or
yes.
memories fade over time.
Yeah.
It's important to try to preserve that evidence and capture that evidence quickly. But we have a call.
Yes, sir. Good morning. You're on the air with John.
Sorry to call back. One more quick question. On deductibles, say you have one incident from a storm and you have a $1,500 deductible and your damages say is 14 and the person says to you, well, you got 15, so you probably shouldn't file that. Then you have some more damage. You have a $2,000 damage and you didn't file for the last one, but then you file for this one. Should you each time, whether it's you meet the deductible or not, should you file each time, or should you not file until you have an amount that surpasses the deductible? I'll hang up and listen to you.
That's a difficult question to answer in a general form with one answer fits all. You would want to look very carefully at the language of your policy. There are sometimes potential risks that the more claims you make, even if you don't make your deductible, that it affects your insurability and companies will elect to not renew your policy or to change your rate. If you're not going to get any benefit from the insurance because the damage is so small that it doesn't meet your deductible, it probably is something that you would want to weigh carefully before you would make a claim. But you need to read your policy very carefully on that and may even consult with the agent who sold you the policy as to what impact that would have and how close is it to the threshold of your coverage. And, you know, you want to, you know, just because if it's your automobile, not all collision repair shops are created equal. And you may want to have your vehicle inspected by two or three different repair shops.
Makes
because
sense, yeah.
They may find that there's more damage than what initially appeared to the first estimate that you had. And it may be something that does in fact exceed your deductible, and it's better to know that before you settle than later. So just because one adjuster has given you an estimate, you have the right to take your vehicle to more than one collision repair shop and to ask them to give itemized statements of what was damaged as a result of the accident and how they're going to repair it. Are they going to repair it with used parts, or will they be repairing it with new factory spec parts?
The question that you asked about a car, like for example, crashing into a fence. Let's say the fence was holding in livestock, and you really had to hurry and get that fence fixed. So you hurry up, you get the fence fixed. Now you go to the insurance company. They say, "Well, we need pictures of it." Well, I'm sorry, it's too late.
Well, I think that would be an exception to the general rule, because the law also places a duty upon a property owner that he has a duty to mitigate his damages. So that means fixing something so that the damage doesn't grow. If the cattle gets out and causes an 18-car collision on I-75, the damages have just gone through the roof because you didn't get out there and spend the money as quickly or take the time to fix the fence or move the cattle to another pasture or something like that. Same thing if a tree limb falls on your roof. You can't just sit back and say, well, I'm going to make an insurance claim, and it's pouring down rain, and the fact that it's raining on my Picasso picture that's hanging right beneath the leak in the roof, I'll just go ahead and send them a bill for the Picasso also, and you're probably not going to get paid for the Picasso under that circumstance.
Oh, wow. But you have to, so you have to hurry.
You have to mitigate your damages as within what a reasonably prudent person would do. And the roof example, at the very least, you would want to put a tarp over the roof and hold it down with some sandbags or some fashion to affix a temporary measure that if it doesn't completely eliminate the continuing damages, it is in mitigation of them to reduce them and reduce the amount of the ultimate damage. And it's measured by what the law calls the reasonably prudent man standard, which means what would a person do under the same or similar circumstances exercising reasonable diligence.
So if somebody in that circumstance came to you to be represented to say, can you go after this insurance company? The car ran through my fence. It cost me $800 to fix it. I just want my $800 back and my...
Those are not practical cases to be handled by any law firm or lawyer because the economics don't justify it.
Oh, okay.
I mean, you know, you don't, and that's why our court system is set up with what's called a summary claims court, which is small claims court, is the way some people refer to it, when the monetary damages are so minor. You don't have to forfeit your right to have your day in court, but you're not going to really find a reputable law firm who will be able economically to take an $800 case on a contingency fee basis that if they don't, you know, they only get paid what they recover, and it takes thousands of dollars of time to get this case prepared or whatever. I mean, I don't practice in that area, but the few times I've been over there, you can go over for your hearing or pretrial conference in your case, and there are 200 cases there, and you could literally sit there for 4 hours before they call your case for a five-minute pretrial conference.
Well,
that 4 hours is productive time, and as Abe Lincoln said, time is the stock and trade of a lawyer.
John, how do we get a hold of you? What's your number?
Our office is Fuller & Fuller Law Firm. Our Ocala number is 352 five four seven 4292. We have a toll-free number, 855-534-2565. We have offices in Ocala and the Villages, and if we can help you, we'll be happy to.
All right, excellent. And call us here at the radio station if you need us to repeat that phone number. John Fuller, always good to see you.
Thank you. Always a pleasure.
Always goes fast, by the way. All right, hang in there. Fox News is coming right up, and we'll be right back.
You're listening to WOCA News Talk 1370, Ocala's source for what's happening in today's hottest, up-to-date news and topics. This is a